Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
Veteran politician who spent several years in the Congress and then decided to move to the BJP. But at this time and age, I think when Mandya is in the news, Mandya the Hemme, the pride of Mandya. I'm joined by Mr. S.M. Krishna himself. Thank you so much for joining us, sir. Let me ask you, what are your plans? Would you be going to Mandya or would you also concentrate on Bangalore a lot more this time for the political campaigning?
I will be going to a few constituencies. I have suggested to the campaign committee of the BJP in the state to decide wherever I have to go. So Mandya would certainly be one of the constituencies where I will have to go. Well, even though the broad framework as to what the who are the candidates is yet to be worked out from the opposition side.
But do you see an advantage of the BJP in that place, especially when we're seeing the JDS and Congress, though they're a coalition partner in the government, but they don't seem to be partners at all in Mandya itself. Do you see chances for the BJP in Mandya at this time?
Well, I think the BJP will have to take a call whether they are going to set up a candidate in Mandya or whether they are going to take some other decision. That's being talked about, that's being discussed. A final picture will emerge in about a week's time.
Yesterday, Mr. Yedrappa was speaking about the chances of the BJP and quite confident the BJP in terms of more than 22 seats out of 28. Is the conference right? Do you think it's the right time for the BJP to feel that they would cross 22 with the performance that was seen in the previous Lok Sabha elections?
Well, Mr. Yediyurappa has been touring the state for the last so many months. So I think he should be knowing the pulse of the people.
But so, personally, what do you see of pulse?
Well, you know, I have not toured much.
Yes.
And whatever my assessment would be on the basis of what I hear and what I read.
And your sharp political acumen that you have.
But BJP has reasonably good chances of increasing its present strength. I think that's my assessment. But when once the final list of candidates from all political parties are decided, then we can make a firm assessment.
Seeing the situation in the country right now, do you think there is a chance for a Modi wave again in 2019? Has Pulwama had its effects? Do you think also that will boost a bit for the BJP?
Well, any development like the Pulwama is going to have a massive impact on the electorate. And there are about 30 crores of people who are first-time voters.
Yes.
You know. So for them, you know, it's going to be a very big challenge. And the strikes on Balakot is a case in point where the youngsters would be thrilled when something like this happens. So I'm confident that Modi will be able to come back to power.
So when he says apna time aayega means his timing was just right in terms of the way the second form of surgical strikes took place?
Things have so conspired which favour the re-emergence of Modi as the Prime Minister.
The 5 years of Modi's performance, and now that we see we go back for that litmus test again, but do you feel that the government could take it forward, or do they still need to work on their mistakes of the previous governance that they may have to in case they get elected again?
Well, based on the experience of the last 5 years, I think they can plan a much more wholesome way, in a more wholesome way to plan for the next 5 years. And I think that the next 5 years of the Modi government is going to be more productive, more purposeful, than what it has been in the last 5 years.
But I'd like to ask you about your role now. What have you chalked out for yourself in this election as your role?
Well, as one who is in the party, I will go wherever I am, I would be of some use to our candidates, and I would be happy to do it.
You said you spent several decades in the Congress. Now, we have seen that the Congress has brought out what they call their Brahmastra, Priyanka Gandhi. She looks like her grandmother. She behaves like her. She connects. That's what is being referred to like Indira Gandhi. And Indira Gandhi was the person who made you the first union minister, if I'm not wrong. So, in looking at that, do you look at them bringing out their Brahmastra of sorts and launching in Gujarat?
Well, I see Indira Gandhi every day, you know. And as much as I see Narendra Modi every day, you know. Well, I don't forget my past, and I'm conscious of my present. How many people have seen Indira Gandhi? Do you think the percentage of people who have seen Indira Gandhi? I don't think that a whole lot of the electorate today have seen Indira Gandhi, because she died in 1984.
Yes.
So to compare Indira Gandhi and then connect Priyanka Gandhi to Indira Gandhi may not mean anything to these 30 crores of youngsters who are going to be first time voters.
But are you saying that she doesn't possess the charisma of Indira Gandhi?
Well, that has to be tested, you know. Indira Gandhi did not become overnight Indira Gandhi what she ultimately became. She became Indira Gandhi only after splitting the Congress, asserting herself, nationalizing the banks, abolishing the privy purses, and then taking formidable steps for land reforms. Then only she emerged as a leader. So Priyanka Gandhi, she is taking baby steps in politics.
What is your assessment of Rahul in the last few years?
Well, he has been a massive failure, you know. I don't think that he has emerged as a prudent, dependable leader with a foresight or with a strategy, you know.
What forced you to quit the Congress? What forced you to quit the Congress? Was it also that one part where Rahul Gandhi itself also
I couldn't accept the hereditary succession, you know. And when I came to know that that's what was going to happen in the Congress, then I thought that I couldn't accept the hereditary succession and accept that as my reference point for leadership. That's why I quit.
But I should ask you this. Congress and now the BJP, they're two big national parties. The shift that we have seen in between the both parties, are you comfortable in the BJP?
Absolutely, you know. Because I don't expect anything from the BJP.
Did you expect something from the Congress at some point of time?
No. Well, Congress gave me what all I was, yes. You know. So there was nothing that I was. But I wanted to live happily thereafter. But unfortunately, this hereditary succession was something which mentally I couldn't reconcile. Hence.
Was Rahul a factor? Was Rahul a factor?
Well, when I say hereditary succession,
I was just waiting for you to spell it out.
Your own guess, you know.
My last question to wrap up this interview, sir. Lok Sabha elections 2019, we are seeing a lot of changes. Like I was saying, Prime Minister Modi is saying, apna time aaya hua hai, and they're asking people and so many million young voters. But a veteran politician like you, what would you like to tell those first-time voters? Because one thing we have seen, there has been an increase in number of people have enrolled, but there's still a bit of disillusionment. Should we vote or not? Because social media plays a very important role in especially shaping ideas today. What would you like to tell them?
No, I think everyone, you know, who is entitled to vote should go to the polling booths and exercise their right to vote. Because what is involved in this election is the success of democracy itself. Whether Modi wins or Modi loses, democracy should win, and democracy wins only when a large percentage of eligible voters go to the polling booths and take the time out and exercise their franchise. Then democracy is safe in India and democracy succeeds.
Thank you so much for talking to us here at the Prince. Thank you very much.